First and the second baron.
I'm sorry, the second, third, sorry.
Yep. Okay. Yeah?
Right. And you're good.
So I should put on the... Is that okay? I put it here?
Yep.
I see.
Yikes!
Come on in. Is it already muted?
Thank you.
Okay.
Good evening. Thank you all for coming. This is the first lecture of the series. We just put the posters up in the stairway so you can see the rest of the lecture series. As you know, we have the lectures on Tuesdays. It says on the poster 5 p.m., but Ted Brown wants to remind me that they're actually going to happen at 5:15. That's because that's when you come, yeah? So we decided to change the time to 5:15. So lectures are Tuesdays, 5:15. We have a couple of lectures that will occur on Friday, Saturday, and Saturday afternoon. Those are all associated with the ACSA conference, the North Regional Conference, which will be excellent this year. It's usually not as excellent this as it is this year. That's because we did it. Yeah, it's true. The first time I ever came here, I came as a speaker for the ACSA conference. That was a long time ago. I don't remember how long ago. In any case, we'll have normal lecture series on Tuesday, and then at the ACSA we'll have three very interesting, I hope, lectures. One by Hernan Diaz Alonso, who's the new director at SciArc, Amal Andreos, who's the new dean at Columbia, on Saturday, and then we'll have a roundtable discussion with them. So it should be. Can you hear? Is this thing even working? Okay. So lecture posters are on either end. You can see the rest of the series. Very, very, very happy tonight. This is the first lecture of the year. Thrilled have Studio Link Arc. Really remarkable office. I don't know if any of you have been to Milan on your private jet up in the summer. But he did the China Pavilion for the Milan Expo, and if you didn't get to see it, you may want to read an article by our own Wan Fei, who wrote a piece in Time in Architecture, which is among the best journals in architecture in a very serious, professional, and this issue, right? It's in the most current issue. There's a review. We wrote a review of the Milan Pavilion, which we're going to see for tonight. Professor Lu is teaching at Tsinghua University in Beijing. He commutes from New York City to Tsinghua. He teaches in Beijing, but he lives in New York City. How can commute from Syracuse to New York City? Professor there now. We hope we'll get him to come and do an undergraduate at Tsinghua. He did a master's degree at Yale University, where he had, as a professor,
professor for his theory. For his and after that, he went to work for Gehry for 3 or so years. Worked on a number of projects. One in particular, a remarkable project that is now adopted and never got more questions about. After that, he worked for Steven Holl and for about another 2 years. Got so good that he decided to make his own office.
Can you help me? Is it okay? Hello? Maybe I should. Maybe I should move to here. Hello.
Thank you.
Maybe you should allow it. Hello. Yeah, it's much better. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, and dear professor, dear students, architecture peers, dear Dean Michael Speaks, Professor Wang Fei, and good afternoon. It is my honor to be here to present our work we have been done in the past 3 years. I guess you guys probably don't know too much about our work, but don't worry, you're gonna hear too much of our work in the next an hour. But actually, I know Syracuse a lot. I know there's a place with lots of talented students, outstanding professor, also the best football and the basketball team, and lots of snow as well. So today's lecture's name is From Nature to Artifacts. So I will very quickly go over the project we have done, and then mainly I will focus on the most recently completed project, the China Pavilion for Milan Expo at 2012. As Michael introduced, right after I graduated from Yale, I worked with my professor, student professor, Frank Gehry. I worked for him for 3 years, mainly work on this project. And then I moved to New York, work for Steven Holl. I was in charge of all of his projects in China. In 2012, I decided to do my own practice studio link up in New York. Why I choose to have the base in New York? So here is the reason. And this is a cartoon drawn by Leon Correa, and it's supposed to describe how the human being looks like after 150 years later. But for me, it's exactly the image comparing the architecture in China and architecture in US. One is so muscular but has no time to think. Another one is all about the brain power but without enough muscle to support his action. So I choosing to build my own practice in New York is to establish a platform to well balance the strengths and the weakness between the Easterns and the Westerns. So our efforts are rewarding. During the past 3 years, we have been doing a couple of very interesting projects. Some of them already get to be built, and some of them are under construction right now. So here, this one is about, is a 80,000 square foot clubhouse was in Beijing, in Guiyang. And this is another gallery, it's only 20,000 square foot size, is in Shenzhen Bay. This project just got to be completed last month. I didn't get a chance to take a picture yet. So here is a 5 million square feet master plan. The first phase is done by Norman Foster. We have been done, we have invited to do the phasing two and phasing three. The project is already under construction at the beginning of last year. Everything goes super fast in China. Here is another competition we have done. It was an international inviting competition. We won 7 votes out of a total of 16. And Norman Foster got 8 votes and RTKL got 1. So even we didn't get the first prize, the client still won't offer 1/3 of the site with 2 high-rise skyscrapers to us. But we decide not to take the job because we are exactly knows still the link arc needed at this moment, which is focus on the project can fulfill our architecture idealism. At the same time of 2013, we was approached by another international inviting competition, which is the China Pavilion for Milan Expo. So here is the site, and all of those national pavilion was there. This is China Pavilion, American Pavilion, French Pavilion, and I think this is a Russian Pavilion. To be honest, I have never think I will do a national pavilion for the expo. Even I never visited a site in Shanghai Expo during my trip to China. At the very beginning, I just think that's a very good opportunity to doing something very cool and put on a website. I never realized we're gonna win until we got the 2 of the first prize for the both of the run. And it was very excited, but I also concerned, because I know it won't be easy, in the next 2 years, it won't be easy ahead of me. One of the reasons is this is the first time China built their own national pavilion overseas. That's the reason, and also the client never has any experience to build a building whenever in China or outside of the country. So that's what I'm very concerned about it. So I guess you'll probably be very familiar with the expo, but I just very quickly go through some famous architecture piece in the expo. Of course, the first one is the Crystal Palace at 1851, and 1889, the Eiffel Tower, 1929, the Barcelona Pavilion by Miss Van der Rohe, and in 1958, the Philips Pavilion done by Corbeau, and the 70s, the Metropolitan, and 2000, the MERDV's Holland Pavilion. In 2010, it was the first time China built their own national pavilion. And everyone has the question, whenever inside of the country, outside, what is the next? What are we going to do after 5 years? Because this is the first time China as a guest to build a contemporary building outside of the country. So I will go over the 5 points, 5 concepts of the China Pavilion from these 5 points. So the first one is the landscape and the city. The second one, field and object. The third one, timber and the structure. I will mainly talk about the structure system. The third is about shadow and the space. And the last, world and China. The client named the theme of China Pavilion is called On the Land of Hope. It was a very famous song in the 1980s. It's right after the Cultural Revolution. At the time, countries, the China start to open its door towards the rest of the world. There's lots of evolution and the changes happened during the year. One of the largest change is on the agriculture field. Before the Cultural Revolution, the central government owns all of the land. But after 1979, the farmers can contract out the land and do their own work. This change largely encouraged the farmers' passion of their work. There's lots of movie and songs to picture that moment in the history. One of the most famous songs is called On the Land of Hope. Actually, the singer is the current First Lady of China. So my office is a very international firm. We have architects from all over the world. So I give them an assignment. Everyone go online to find their own image. Talk with me, which is the meaning for them about On the Land of Hope. So I realize there are so many different possibilities to so many elements to describe about this country. It could be the nature landscape. It could be material for the food. It could be a diagram for bioeconomy. And it also could be the biomedicine. And also could be a crazy food industrial in China. And could be the landform. This is a nice image for us. It's a piece of farmland with farm working in the field and the kids getting off the school. Is it beautiful? But this kind of lovely image is start to disappear thanks to the larger scale of the urbanization process. We just realized there are so many elements can describe about this China. Maybe everyone has their own imagination about this country. So rather than we focus on finding one element to describe, to define the country, we would like to using more abstract and poetic way to make this concept. So our form generation of China Pavilion is very simple. We established a roof line by connecting the Beijing CBD skyline, which is here, with the contour of the nature, the range of the nature mountain in China, which creates a very beautiful dynamic space inside. It is an expression of hope that the cities and nature can exist in harmony. When we zoom out, you will find there is an ongoing dialogue between the profile of the Chinese mountain with the Arabic mountain in a long distance in the background, which makes us very like this picture. There is a lot of argument and discussion about the master plan of Expo. So our response to the Expo master plan is from our expect of the field and object. There's the Expo site, and the downtown Milan is here. There's a train station, railway train is go all the way to there. So at when Milan won the Expo application, there's a group of the master plan designer was invited to design the Expo master plan. They're including Gehry and some professor from Milan Polytech, and also Herzog as well. So from the master plan designer, their original idea is try to avoid the overexpression of each country's national pride, and to switch the each country's focus to how to specific response to the theme of Milan Expo. And from their idea, the main axis of the Milan Expo is assembled to the table of this famous Da Vinci's table. It's going to be a piece of the axis of a plaza with full of the food from all over the world. But the mayor of the Milan, they take the physical idea of the master plan, but doesn't realize all of the concept of their master plan. That's why Herzog quit the team, and he also had a very interesting interview he put online. If any of you are interested in, you can check their website and find that article. So here is the site for China Pavilion. And on the back side, there is a beautiful water feature on the north of the China Pavilion. This is the second largest pavilion in this town. So based on our understanding about the master plan, we decide we are not going to do another landmark object like some pavilion has already done in Shanghai Expo, but we are going to design a pavilion is all about the field. So based on that, we did a series of the study of the relationship between the object and the field. So here is four studies about the relationship between them. The field and object can be the first field of object, the second field as objects, the third object as field, and we choose the last, the field is the object. As I mentioned, the China Pavilion's roofline is connected by the nature landscape profile on the south side and the city skyline profile on the north side. In this case, we're going to call the south side called its soft edge, and the north side is the hard edge, which creates the first pair of the contrast. Here is the photo during the construction. China Pavilion actually set back about 35 meters from the main axis of the master plan. All the visitors have to enter the building through a piece of the landscape about 35 meters. After the expo opened, actually I work around the site. I just realized most of the pavilions there, they built right next to the axis, which gave a lot of pressure to the main master plan. China Pavilion, French Pavilion, and the Germany Pavilion are the only three pavilions sharing the same site strategy. So for the south side, you will see the soft edge is seamlessly connected to the landscape in front of it. On the north side, the hard edge has a more defined cut. With the water feature on the adjacent water feature, it forms the second pair of the contrast. This is the north elevation. And also on the south elevation, the edge of the south edge is more zigzag. And the elevation the curtain wall, we pushed back about 6 meters from the edge of the bamboo panel. In this way, there is going to create a very beautiful shadow on the curtain wall itself. But on the north edge, the edge is more defined. And the curtain wall is only pushed 2.5 meters from the boundary of the bamboo panel. So this elevation is more defined. It's kind of like an ending. So the southeast corner of the roof is slightly tilted downwards to the landscape to create a piece of field. All the visitor has to enter the building from under the roof. So although the main entrance of China Pavilion is only on the southeast corner, but the entire building is totally open to the four direction. And we also keep all the structure roof line is about 50 millimeter higher than the existing landscape and the installation. So when you look at this level, you're going to see the entire roof line is floating above a piece of the landscape. So here is some site study we did to do the comparison. The working methodology in our office is instead of we get some concept very quick, we are test a different object, test a different form to try to get a dialogue between the object and this context. These are all the process study we had. From now, probably you know how we adjust doing a very subtle adjustment to express our understanding about the mass plan done by Herzog. So now I would like to introduce the circulation of China Pavilion. The entire project for us is a big exhibition. The exhibition is start outside of the pavilion. The main entrance zone is very gently sloped down into a public waiting area. People will enter the perfect space at here and filter into an exhibition space beneath the multimedia hall. For us, all those hatch, they are a piece of field. And all those exhibition space program is kind of curved out the program inside of this field. Similar with the Pac-Man video game. So the elevation of the landscape, elevation of the form of the field going to be the elevation for the exhibition. Then the visitor will walk up a gently sloped stair to a panorama platform. From there, they will view a LED matrix installation integrated into the landscape. Visitors then will enter into a multimedia hall for a short film. This film will focus on the Chinese Spring Festival. The visitors then step outside of the pavilion onto a bridge above the roof. And then they come back to the interior space. The whole sequence concludes with a monumental higher timber structure space. So let's move on to the part three, which is the timber and the scale. China Pavilion used glulam as the main construction material. Glulam technology basically is originally from Europe. But we are using this contemporary glulam technology to explore the traditional architectural values, such as space, material, and light. As I mentioned, the roof of the China Pavilion is very abstract. If we cut a series of the section from the North Age to the South Age, we will get a series of the section. Each of the section are different. And you will find the very subtle transition between the each of the sections. Once we transform this diagram into the structure, we will get the section which is each of the rafter are different. They are subtly very, each of them very subtly different. It's like the famous quail photography work. It's like an animation. Each action naturally leads to the next one. Without any of the film, the animation won't exist. It's also like famous Duzan's oil painting, the nude descending a staircase. So in this case, the structure is not only a structure, but also an expression of the concept. From the interior, you are going to find a very subtle transition from the rafter to rafter from the both direction. This one is from south towards, looks towards north. Here is north towards the south. You will see this kind of transaction creates a very subtle dynamic interior space. When we do the design, we also try our best to detach this wood structure with the wall and all the vertical structure member. So from any of the view on the second floor, you will look through the entire building without any view blocking. The entire roof consists about 37 pieces of the rafter. We call this structure is rafter, and 40 pieces of the purlins. There are 6 of the rafter and 5 of the purlin are made up of steel. The reason we have those steel reinforced is we are focused on to create a very lightweight roof to allow the largest span exhibition space beneath the roof. So the roof line is filled with a very rich detail. For example, the steel and the timber and the steel, etc. There's in total 1,400 different types of the joints on the roof. Each of the joints, actually, they're different. So here is a very typical detail. In order to fix the steel with the purlin, we need to install a customized steel plate on the steel structure, and then we're gonna fix a glulam rafter on it. Each of the glulam, these cuts has to be customized CNC'd. To cut a pocket, this pocket will fit the steel plate inside of it. And then we're gonna have the steel downwards to fix the glulam and the steel. At the last step, we're gonna have the wood caps to cover the hole. Here is the process to make one joint. This is the manufacturer, they had a machine called dynamic mold. They can make the glulam each piece by 2 hours. And you need 2 or 3 days to dry the entire piece of the glulam. And they should have at least a 3-axis CNC machine to cut the pocket. Because there's 1,400 pieces of the joints, so all of those pockets has to be customized. Each of them are different. And here is the largest steel plate hide inside of the timber structure, weighing 95 kilogram. And this is the most complicated one. And here is 1-to-1 mock-up for the wood joints. We even fully control the texture of each piece of the glulam, and also negotiate with the manufacturer to cut down the shadow gap from the 5 millimeter to 2 millimeter. It takes us like 2 days to negotiate with the manufacturer. Here comes some construction photos. That's the complete photo. So all the timber structure was complete in a very delicate way. Actually, we learned a lot from the entire construction process. Here is some photo. We went to the manufacturing company to discuss the color of the timber material. We realized with the different height and with different time of a day, each and the glulam color will look very different. So after a 3 long trip, go back and forth, we realized the only color we want is just a very light coat of the water-based coat put on the glulam. That's what we want. Everyone was so excited to see the process is going on. So the part 4, I would like to introduce about the parametric design. China Pavilion using parametric design for the roof paneling system. But rather than focus on the parametric itself, we would like to go back to the original spatial experience, which for us is kind of like Louis Kahn mentioned. A great piece of architecture always start from something immeasurable, go through with the measurable, and ending with something unmeasurable. As I mentioned, the entire roof system of China Pavilion is very precise and very accurate system. So from the bottom to top, it's includes 4 layers. Is the layer of the roof system, a layer of the PVC waterproof layer, and a layer as a system of the bamboo supporters. And on the above, there is a series of the bamboo panels was parametrically designed as a shading system. So two strategy for parametric design the skin. One is how Zaha did. From Zaha's project, the space between the structure and the skin is always the same. In this case, we need a lot of budget to customize each of the panel because each of the panel are different. Another way is EMBT did for the Span Pavilion in Shanghai. In this project, each of the panel are the same. So in this case, all the supporter needs to be universal, which means it needs a lot of time to study and to install a universal system to support the panel above it. So two strategies. One needs time, one needs budget. China Pavilion is a project with very limited budget and also very tight schedule. So we have to make a balance. So here comes how we using parametric tool to rationalize, optimize the entire roof system. So each panel are different. And then we simplify it. One color means one type of the panel. There's 1,052 pieces of the panel above the roof of China Pavilion. So when we zoom in, you will find each of panel is 3D defined with the shape, with the size, and with the number. So all of those panel is, even one piece of panel is also very international cooperated. All the bamboo strip is made in China, and the aluminum frame is in China, and all of them are assembled in Italy. And shipped to the site, all the installers, they are professional climber from Germany. So when we unfold all those panels, we get this diagram for the bamboo types and the number of the bamboo panel. There's in total 1,052 pieces of the panel with the different types. You will find there are some panel with more types, and the most of the panel are different. So we are using this diagram to control the type of the panel and the amount of panel to make a balance, make sure the project can be installed on time. There are some model shoots we get for the environment of those space. China Pavilion uses a lot of sustainable material, for example, wood, bamboo, OSB as an exterior wall material. But we also try the best to eliminate all the curtain walls to have the natural ventilation in the space and cooling down the space. All the AC machine also limited the number. There's only a few VIP space has the air condition. In this case, the roof panel system is the shading system. Here is the diagram we made. According to the calculation, we realize with 75% of the perforation rate, the temperature inside of the China Pavilion will be 3 to 5 degrees lower than the exterior space, especially in summer. Instead of we doing something by pattern, I would like to say we more want a texture for the China Pavilion. So we're choosing the most simplest scheme for the pattern of China Pavilion, of the panel. From the outside of the building, this pattern actually it's reinforced the direction of the panel and also floats above the roof. From the inside, the shadow of those panels will create a very dynamic interior space, like the pencil sketch. In order to make sure all the construction outcome will be similar with what we want, we simultaneously build a larger scale of the model in-house or inside of our studio. So here is the model shoots. Here is the final construction photo. Model shoots, the final quality. Model shoots, the final image. This sentence is something I really like. It's talk about the construction. The construction accords the material in its opening towards light, a means of expression its inherent color. When stone is placed up on stone, its forms resides in the joint. The shadow of those bamboo panels is create an environment varies in the different date, time, and weather to create a very dynamic spatial experience. So let's move on to the last part, is the international cooperation. As I mentioned, China Pavilion is the first time China built its own national pavilion outside of the country. It's a very difficult project. We only have about 7 months, start from the appointment of general contract to the completion of construction. And also all the design is very complicated because this type of the roof has never been done before. As a result, each of the joints we must fully study and also doing the research. I have done a few lectures about China Pavilion. It has become more and more clear to me that tectonically, this typical joint, is the key of the entire project. So here is the structure and the bamboo panel. We need a supporter to penetrate with the waterproof layer to capture the panel. Because we are going to have 1,400 pieces of the bamboo panel, each of them are different. And each panel needs three or four supporters. In this case, we are going to have around 4,000 pieces of the bamboo supporters, and each of them, most of them are different. In this case, we need to create a very precise system to understand not only from the architecture side, it's also from the constructor side. And also very difficult part is here. Because the more distance we had at this moment, the water gonna stay here without go over the roof. Water is a very interesting material. It's always leaked to everywhere. As long as you have him stay on the roof, have it stay on the roof, anyway, after 1 or 2 months, it start to leak to the inside. So we have to find a very efficient way to get this moment to be resolved. Here is some sketch we did at really beginning together with our Italian general contract. About the waterproof layer, if we unfold the waterproof layer, rather than we saw a piece of rectangle, actually we saw a piece of shape. It's more like a skirt. The blue line is the direction of the panel, and the red point is the location of the support. So here is we found a very specific PVC material. Usually the PVC material is about 90% to 95% translucency rate, but this new material can get about 65% of the translucency rate. And also, it's only 1.5 millimeter thick, but the contractor can stand above it to do the construction. This is an image for those professional climbers working on the roof. It's very fun. Here comes the joint, the typical joint design for at the end. This is the PVC layer, and we are going to customize a very precise aluminum profile all the way around the rafter. And then we are going to install. There's a track above the aluminum profile, and then we're going to have a supporter to screw down onto the aluminum profile to capture those panels. This is one of the rafter. All those number is the location of the supporter. most of the supporters are different. So from the design, the height or the height angle, and so also the location of each supporter need to be very precisely defined. And then we're going to ship this deliver this information to our general contract. In our office, we had a French architect. He is working very engineer-oriented. And also in the general contract, it's very interesting. In Italy, lots of general contracts, they had architecture education background. They exactly seamlessly working with us to go through of all the technical detail. Especially for this kind of detail, the 2D submission drawing is totally useless. We have to go with everything in the 3D. So here is the installer. They named each of the supporter and put down before they install all those supporters. Even each of these angles, we have a small tape on the adhere to give them the direction. So the idea of this building is all the contractors, they are going to install the entire pavilion. It's like install a piece of IKEA furniture without their too many thinking of the, without the contract too many consider about the quality. Here is some construction photo. You will find the contractor there stand directly on the PVC layer. Even all of those panels was very well defined in the parametric tool. We have to manually check each of the panels angle, shape, make sure there's no any confliction into the construction and there's no overlap between the different panels. So here is the construction photo. Interior space. Those shadows create a beautiful interior spatial experience. All of those panels needs to be, the weight needs to be less than 60 kilograms. Because according to the Italian code, any weight of the panel above 60 kilogram, we need three contractor stand on the roof, which brings more trouble for the installation. But at the end, we realize those installers, one people can install one piece of panel. Each panel is about 3.5 meter long and one meter width. Here is the complete photo. This is a photo for a part of the roof is completed. Which panel was installed in a runway? Yeah, this one. We had this parallel pattern inside of the bamboo, and outside is all those waving pattern. So even we think we understand each panel, each piece of the panel of this 1052, we have no idea what's going on happening here. We saw this picture right after all the crane was removed. And my colleague said, Yichen, maybe we should Photoshop it. Yeah, I have no idea what's happened during the construction. That's the night view from the water feature. So I guess many of you may have not been able to visit the Milan Expo. Allow me to be your tour guide to in the next few minutes. Here is the southeast corner of the China Pavilion. That's for us, this is a piece of field, and that's an object above the field. And people will filter into exhibition space beneath the auditorium space. And we use a very beautiful metal mesh to cover the metal deck and all the MEP equipment above it. You will see a very small piece of the architecture from the exhibition space. And then you start to walk up and from this slope stair, you get to a panorama platform of the second floor. So the shadow of the bamboo actually is changing the space according to the time. And here's about 22,000 pieces of the LED sticks to create a matrix installation. Have some animation, or it's always changing with some music of On the Land of Hope. I listened to this music for the almost a month. This music is every 10 minutes they start again and again. So right after I go back to New York, even when I take a shower, I always have the same music in my mouth. So you will see this dynamic space inside of it. And from the west to east, all those purling is perfect, doing a perfect transition between each other. The waiting area outside of the auditorium. The auditorium space. When you step up the auditorium, you are going to get into a space in between the exterior and the interior. The client asked me a question, do you have a glass here? I said, no, it's an exterior space. Yeah, so they had some problem to understand what means the gray space. When you step up to a metal duct, on a metal duct bridge, we are going to very closely read all the patterns of the bamboo. So from the inside, we saw we had the view of the interior of the bamboo. Now we switch to the another side. It's kind of from the inside out. When you look back to the auditorium object, that's a very strong figure. Everyone will have the souvenir photo on this bridge. And you leave the building from this opening. And the sequence concludes with this monumental space. You look at that for the interior of the bamboo panel. There's some detail of the panels. There's some bamboo panel is folded with a technical joint there. Even some supporter still had a number on it. There's some detail of the bamboo panel. Not only the schedule is very tight, the entire project site is also limited. We only have two cranes working on the site. And the size of the site is limited. We have to work very closely with the general contract to find the most efficient way using the site. So we decide to build this building from all the way north to the south. So that's the process. After installing the glulam, people will install those waterproof and the bamboo. At the one third of the bamboo panel was fixed, people realize there's one day it's raining. People realize there's somewhere is leaking, and we have no idea where is the wrong place. So the contractor start to remove all the bamboo panel. It takes a month to install and take another half month to remove all the panels. We have to check each of the, very detailedly check each of the detail to make sure which part is leak. So in this case, the construction start to install the bamboo panel from south. And from that time, we only have about a month to finish the entire project. The project is also very international cooperated. What I present to you is only the architecture part. There is a landscape design, interior design, MEP design, lighting design also happens simultaneously in China. So our parametric design engineer, he's my ex-coworker in Morphosis. And our curtain work consultant there in China, and our general contract is in Italy. Interior design is in China and New York. And curtain wall is in Shanghai. So as long as there's one more group of people, the architecture has one more connection need to take care of. In order to get a project with quality, usually we need three elements: design, budget, and time. At any of the chance, if we have two of the elements, we still can get a quality project. For example, we have design and a budget. We don't have time, so we can pay the contractor more, and to get them to build seven a week, 24 hours a day. And if we have design, the time, we don't have budget. We can have them build slowly, and we will have enough time to figure out everything in the design. But the China Pavilion, as I mentioned, it's a very limited project with very limited time, and also the budget per square meter is only 1/5 or 1/6 of the other pavilion, like a Germany pavilion and a Swiss pavilion. That's why architecture has to involve into all the process of the construction. We even made our own handbook of the construction and delivered this book to the general contract. We make a very clear diagram for each step of the construction installation. The Italian manufacturers, they love this book. You know, they try to keep it. I told them that's not a souvenir. It's a guide for the construction. So we fully involve into all the construction process with all the different manufacturing company. So here comes, there's an animation for the, mine doesn't work. I think maybe that's fine. Yeah, it's a construction animation for the construction process. I think when I click it, it should work. Maybe I bring it back. Oh. Let's double click it. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, unfortunately, the animation, it doesn't work. But it's a, we install a couple of camera on the roof and outside of the pavilion to record all the construction process. So we work, as I mentioned, we work very closely with our LDI and our general contract. So we looks like this occasionally. And actually, we look like that most of the time. So there are some, but this image, there are some budget issue. The general contractor bring us into a container and close the door. You have to sign the contract and then let you leave. And that's how we always look like during the time. And 2 days before the construction to be complete, the client, the general contractor tried to bring us to a restaurant, try to make us drunk, because they hope we can disappear in the next 2 days before the opening. And our strategy is we bring the Chinese white wine. I guess you guys never want to try it. You're gonna look like them. With all those efforts, the China Pavilion was completed before the May 1st. I don't like this picture at the really beginning because it's too busy for me. And then I start to like it after a while. The reason is I think my focus start to switch to observe how people are using this building. As one of the most popular pavilions in Milan Expo, China Pavilion has about 20,000 visitors every day. To me, architects does not change anything. We simply transform the reality. So here comes the end of my lecture. Thank you for your time, and I will be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Any question?
Thanks for the lecture. You brought up desire drive, design, time, and quality. I was wondering if you think that we have to spend so much time in studio to get really good design, like, do you think that affects the culture in some way?
Yeah, architecture is a very, very difficult profession because we usually takes more than the time doctor or lawyer takes for their profession, and we get the scale for design, and then we will realize how difficult at reality as well. So when I in school, I remember I used to send an email to Frank Gehry, I said, I might just want to be a paper architect without do any professional work. And Frank sent me a very short word. He said, Yichen, reality always the best. So I hope that can answer your question. Like what I said, architecture, simply we just transfer the reality. For me, give you an example. Guggenheim Abu Dhabi is a project I worked. I think I will never have a chance to do a project like Guggenheim Abu Dhabi. We never worry about the budget. We never worry about the structure. The clients let us do whatever we want. So we spend about 3 years to do the SD. I'm the people in charge of it. Every day I just need to take care of my glue gun and the paper. But for me, that's very unreal, because the architecture needs to take the responsibility for the real world. That's something more interesting than only doing the design. Half-half. At the very beginning, our concept is have the curtain wall go all the way to enclose the entire building. And then we realized the entire the electronic is very limited. We cannot go above a certain moment. That standard is the Gemini Pavilion, because they are very sustainable. So we don't want to using more power, more electricity than the Gemini Pavilion. So in this case, after our calculation, we realize we only can keep a very limited space using the air condition. Then we did one action is eliminate most of the curtain wall. And certainly we realized the project start to be open to the public. And it's amazing to create the very strong relationship from the exterior to the interior. And it's a temporary project. It makes sense to using less energy to keep the building. And also, one of the reasons we eliminate most of the curtain wall is in the restaurant, the people try to cook some Beijing duck. Using electronic, it takes a lot of power. So in this case, we also try to save some energy for it.
You know, so often when we hear about the narrative of a project, mm-hmm. you know, you did it seems almost inevitable at the end.
I think there's the reason I go over the project by 5 points is five elements. I think it's very crucial to develop this project. So at the first, I'm talking about how to respond to the theme of the project. Because in China, it's very important, especially this kind of landmark project. We have to create a very strong story to bring the client in. So the second part is very important, how we take the responsibility to respond to the master plan. For example, I think one of the most crucial part is what I'm thinking, how this building to have a dialogue with the horizon. It's very different. After the expo opened, I walk away the expo, I realize only the China Pavilion is doing something dialogue with the horizon. For example, the Australian Pavilion and the French Pavilion, they are all about the wall, about the vertical space. So they create a very enclosure and very intimate contemporary architecture space. But even we are using some glue lamp material, we are using some parametric design, you will find this building is all about the horizon. That's for me is something I realized after the building to be built. Maybe that's something is already in our blood. So we designed not intentionally, but afterwards, I think that's the very crucial part. Very good question. At the really beginning, the process we choosing the PVC material, it takes about half a year. At the really beginning, our initial response is using PVC material, and another material called ETFE. But that material is very easy to be broke. Then, according to our engineer, curtain wall engineer suggestion, we are trying to using a curved glass, which can made in China and with very precise quality and a very low price. I just realized in China, those curved glass industrial is very high end. Or the Sajima and the Tom Mann's project, those curved glass actually is shipped from China. But when we deliver this information to Italian, the Italian general contract, they are very uncomfortable using the glass because during the ship, those glass, during the shipping, those glass going to broken by themselves. And in Italy, their response is using a polycarbonate. And then we have about 3 or 4 months to study all the polycarbonate detail for the roof layer. But when we go to Italy to look at the 1-to-1 mock-up, the Italian general contract, they bring up another material. When we look at it, it's go back to our initial response, it's the PVC. They found a PVC material from Japan. So we had a long time to compare between the quality of PVC, this type of PVC, and the polycarbonate. At that time, I started to realize we don't want a totally transparent material. We want some material can block the view, but you also can capture the shadow and you can view a little bit texture of the pattern, bamboo pattern above it. Then we realized, okay, at the end, the PVC material is the best option for this waterproof layer. What I told you is, and usually the material choosing or something related to the construction is not always the architect give the direction. You have to do comparison, you have to talk with people, and then you're gonna find the best solution for it. So instead of we had a very clear aspect to know what we get at the very beginning, actually what we do is just push the project, move on. And then, as long as the project's on the right track, it will automatically resolve lots of problems. And in the end, you get something to be built.
Last one.
OK.
Yeah, so the first question, yes, we had some sustainable design engineer working with us at the really beginning. And end up we realized according to our strategy, we can have a pretty good sustainable system inside of this pavilion according to the perforation rate. And also you will see the south, the east to west, and from south to north, most of the space are opened. For the after expo, it's very interesting. This question, when I have the lecture in Italy, people always ask this question as the first one. Yeah. There is a symposium in Milan last month. It's about after expo dialogue between the Shanghai Expo master plan and designer with the Milan Expo architects. So I realized these two conversations is actually on a different stage. In the aspect from China, the developer or the architect, they are still focused on how to using this land, how to develop this expo area. But in the Italian side, people keep in talking about how to sustainable design it, how to fully take advantage, take responsibility for the other people, for the nature, and even for the animal around the site. So I think there all these conditions are on the different stage. For China Pavilion, entire building is assembled. So the current plan is we are going to disassemble the pavilion and install and put in the container and ship to China. There's a place in China called Laoshan. It's a very beautiful mountain. We find a place to locate this pavilion. But I, to be honest, I don't want to talk too much about this reassembled building because it probably takes another 2 or 3 years for me. Because I think even it's gonna be even more complicated than build a new pavilion. But that's what we're gonna do in the next. Yeah. To be honest, I was trying to look at how Wang Shu make a lecture. I tried to put some Chinese philosophy in the PowerPoint, and then I realized it doesn't work. Because all of my discussion is very, I think it's very conceptual, and maybe because of my background, I think the Chinese philosopher is something inside of blood. Of our blood is we not for to me is not necessary for each lecture I bring this on the table. For example, there's one example. We had a very good structural engineer in New York. They start to do the pavilion expo pavilion start at 1979. The principal working with us, he is from Swiss and had education from ETH. He is very aggressive, very type of the Western type of the engineer. He had a very intelligent and smart idea for the structure system. Some of them is more aggressive than this, but I only give him one comment: is I want a structure follow the concept. And instead of people watch the structure self-expression, I would like to the structure step back, stand back, and the space going to the front. I don't know if you understand about this. After that, my engineer told me, you are very Asian. Because he said, you know, for example, using the Gulam, Frank Gehry also using a Gulam for his Louis Vuitton project. In school, I can do some piece of the work exactly like his. But after I doing my own practice, I realized I want space calm down. I want all of the structure material to be the background. And the people's action, people's movements going to be the front ground. That's something, I don't know if that's a philosopher from traditional China, but that's something in my blood.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.